God, I'm begging, please again, I need you. Oh, I need you. Walking down these desert roads, water for my thirsty soul, I need you. Oh, I need you. Your forgiveness.
Good morning, friends, and welcome. Welcome to the gathering. I'm Mike Marshall, one of the pastors here. For those of you online, thank you for worshiping and for letting us know that you are worshiping. Here in the sanctuary, great to see you. Thank you for filling out the attendance pads that you see nearby. We always want to be able to follow up with you. So many exciting things going on in our church. 2 weeks from today will be the next Healthy Plate Discipleship Breakfast. It's such a fun experience. Go to our website. You can register there. For the First Street Methodist Mission, our scavenger hunt item in May is infant formula. So if you're able to pick some up, we appreciate that. You can bring that to the church. And we want you to know that on June 26th will be Dr. Tim Brewster's final Sunday before his retirement. That Sunday, we are having one worship service at 9:30. It is going to be a traditional style service. All of us will send off Dr. B that way. Now, as many of you know, Aaron Yipia has served as the Cornerstone Youth Choir Director for the past 6 years. And to have more time with her family, she's made the difficult decision to step down at the end of June. We are so grateful to Aaron for all the positive impacts and the ways that she has loved on our youth, and we want nothing but the best for her and for her family. And she's going to be passing the baton to another member of our staff. We know those shoes. Yes. Mark Burrows, Mr. Mark, beginning in July, will direct all of the choirs for children from kindergarten up through 12th grade. And today, over in the Justin Youth Building, beginning at 10:30 and going up to 11 o'clock or even after that, Mr. Mark would love to talk with our youth who are going into sixth grade and above this fall, and with parents. He wants to know your ideas. He wants to know the creative expressions that you enjoy, because he's going to be creating a community. It's going to be singing and so much more. So do go chat with Mr. Mark. Time for us to begin, friends. Let's stand for the call to worship. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
And pretty soon we're going to walk on over, but we're going to open up with worship this morning with a song called I Am. This is one that we've done a few years ago, and it says this at the very beginning. There's no space that his love can't reach. There's no place where we can't find peace. And so as we invite God into this place and open our hearts and minds to where he might be moving in our lives, let's do that. Let's open ourselves up to God and what God is calling us to this morning as we lift him up in praise.
There's no space that his love can't reach. There's no place where we can't find peace. There's no end to amazing grace.
Sing, take me in.
Take me with your arms spread wide. Take me like an orphan child. Never let go, never leave my side. I am holding on to you. I am holding on to you. In the middle of the storm, I am holding on. I am. In love like this, oh my God, too. I am overwhelmed with the joy divine. There's no space that his love can't reach. There's no place where we can't find peace. There's no end to amazing grace. I am holding on to you. I am holding on to you. In the middle of the storm, I am holding on. I am.
Amen. Amen. Please be seated. everyone, there are a few things that are more special in the life of a family, in the life of a church, than welcoming a new one into our community through the sacrament of baptism. It is in that spirit I would like to invite the Brown family forward for the baptism of their son, Mac Wills. If you'll stand and face everyone so they can see him. Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All of this is God's gift offered to us without price. I present Mac Wills Brown for baptism. Now, on behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, say, I do.
I do.
Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, say, I do.
I do.
Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, all nations, and all races? If so, say, I do.
I do.
And finally, will you nurture Mac in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and example, he may be guided to accept God's grace for himself, to profess his faith openly, and to lead a Christian life? If so, say, I will.
I will.
Hey, Mac. I'm glad I didn't wear a bow tie, too. We would have been too matchy. Mac Wills, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and pray God's richest blessings upon you now and every day of your life. Amen. Would you put your hands on him with me too, please? Mac, the Holy Spirit work within you, that being born through water and the Spirit, you may grow as a faithful disciple of your Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Okay, y'all can't see how blue these eyes are, so I'm gonna come row by row. Yeah. Y'all, when we baptize Mac, when we baptize babies, when we baptize young people, when we baptize adults, we do so as a sign of welcoming into the community and saying, you're not alone. You've never been alone. You've always been seen. You've always been known. You've always been loved and supported. And not only do we show you that, we model it for you. Because like God is always there for you, we're always there for you too. And if you're one of the people that's going to be there for Mac and children like him, would you indicate so by a round of applause? Amen. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Congratulations. Friends, it is a special day in the life of our church today. I'm going to be talking a little bit more about that. If this is your first time here, welcome. We're doing something a little special in the second half of the service that I'll be talking about. And included in that is going to be a sacrament. So the sacraments are incredibly important in the life of the church. There are two sacraments in the Methodist Church. One is baptism. It's a once-in-a-lifetime thing. It can't ever be redone because it can't ever be undone. It's a work that God does in our lives. The second sacrament is a sacrament that we do every time we come together as a church, the sacrament of Holy Communion, a chance to taste, touch, feel, and know the presence of Christ with us. And we do that every time we have a chance to worship together as the gathering, because we always need that reconnecting reminder of the presence of Christ with us. And there's a third unofficial sacrament unique to the gathering worship service, and that is kolaches. And kolaches have been absent for too long. COVID messed up so much. Included in that was kolaches. In just a moment, we're going to be going back and concluding our worship service and re-blessing and reconsecrating Wesley Hall to the making of disciples and the worship of God. And included in that is going to be 24 dozen kolaches. Because you cannot put a limit on God's goodness. And when you live sacrificially so that you can live generously, you make possible things like a church that can have breakfast for people when they show up. When you give sacrificially to the life of your church, you make things possible, like a church that can welcome people in with hospitality and grace, no matter who they are or where they're from, because of what you've done. And we're going to come forward with a time of offering right now. I want to invite our ushers to do so. And know that when you give, when you support, you make possible things like children's ministry. They're going to raise up children like Mac, things like youth ministry that are active in the life of young people through choirs and other forms of discipleship, things like adult Sunday school classes, times of worship. worship together, and yes, even kolaches. So thank you for your continued generosity. If you're one of the people, like the majority of our church, who gives online, you can do so now or anytime by going to fumcfw.org/givenow and make a gift to the operating budget of the church. You can also place a gift in the basket as it comes by. Families like mine that give online typically like to take the card from the back of the pew in front of you that says, "I give online," and place that as a marker in the basket as it comes around. We do that to indicate to our children and show them that we too are a part of faithfully serving and supporting the life of the church. Now, would you please join me as we bless these offerings? Great and loving God, we give you thanks for your continued work in and through this church. Please take these gifts and use them for the strengthening of the body of Christ, your church, and the coming of your kingdom. And it's in Christ's name that we trust and that we pray and say, Amen.
So I run to the fire. move. Thank you, Clint and the band. Right now, we will be reading the scripture, and I invite you to take your Bible. We do encourage you to bring your Bible to church and follow me as I read, maybe even mark or highlight something. And as you listen to the sermon, we also encourage you to keep your text open before you so that you could follow along. So the scripture today comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 5, and we'll start reading in the beginning. Again, it's John chapter 5. We start in verse 1. After this, there was a Jewish festival, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In Jerusalem, near the Sheep Gate, in the north city wall, is a pool with the Aramaic name Bethesda. It had five covered porches and a crowd of people who were sick, blind, lame, and paralyzed sat there. Sometimes an angel would come down to the pool and stir up the water. Then the first one going into the water after it had been stirred up was cured of any sickness. A certain man was there who had been sick for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there, knowing that he had already been there a long time, he asked him, "Do you want to get well?" The sick man answered him, "Sir, I don't have anyone who can put me in the water when it is stirred up. When I'm trying to get to it, someone else has gotten in ahead of me." Jesus said to him, "Get up, pick up your mat, and walk." Immediately, the man was well, and he picked up his mat and walked. Now that day was the Sabbath. God speaks to us through the reading of the scripture. Thanks be to God.
Amen. Hello, everyone. Good morning and welcome. My name is Lance Marshall. I'm one of the co-senior pastors here at the church. Before we consider today's scripture reading and today's message, I want to thank all of the volunteers and ministry partners who are part of our church today and every day. Thanks to everyone who's teaching, who's connecting us online. Thanks for all the folks who are a part of our hospitality team, our ushers, all of you. Thank you so much. The band is not upset with me. They are moving over to get ready in the next worship space. So thank you guys so much for being so flexible today. They've had to do multiple sound checks in multiple spaces. I really appreciate it. It's been a special week for me. Obviously, it's a special week because a construction project that we've been working on for a number of years is reaching a point of substantial completion and get to go and use our new spaces that have been prepared for us. But it's also been a special week for me personally. This Thursday that I just went past was my 9th anniversary of ministry at First Church. And it was really special. Oh, thank you very much. It was very special. It's very meaningful. And I was in my feelings thinking a lot about it, but what the last 9 years have been like. And probably the biggest lesson I've learned of 9 years of being your pastor, of 9 years of getting to know you, of walking alongside you, and getting to know just thousands of people through the life of this church, one of the biggest lessons I've learned is that you have no idea the stuff that other people are going through. You just really don't. You have no idea the stuff that's going on in other people's lives, the stuff that's going on in other people's relationships, in other people's spiritual history, in other people's souls. You just have no idea what's going on in their lives. And especially, you have no idea what's going on if things look really great from the outside. It doesn't matter how clean the Land Rover is when it pulls into the parking lot. Right? It doesn't matter how well the business seems to be going. It doesn't matter how perfectly pressed the Patagonia vest is, right? It doesn't matter how wonderful and smiley and perfect orthodontia everyone is on Instagram. You just have no way of knowing what's actually going on in the lives of other people, particularly, especially when it seems like everything is going so well. I've discovered this over time of being invited to your life and getting to sit down at your home or getting to hear your stories. And every single one of you has something going on that is difficult, that is tough, that is trying, that is exhausting, that is challenging, that is threatening, that is hard. Can't tell you how many times I've had a chance to sit with you, and I've also wanted you to know that there is no way that you're alone. Because you can seem so alone. right? When all of a sudden your relationship is falling apart or is failing to materialize and everyone else's just seems to be going so smoothly. When your career is being uprooted or completely laid asunder and everyone else seems to have no difficulties or troubles. When all of a sudden your children are really, really struggling and there's no way to just snap your fingers and fix it and everyone else's seem to be so normal. You're never alone in this, and it gets made to feel so much worse if you're feeling isolated or disconnected or lost or alone. 6 years ago, we started a worship service called The Gathering, and it was rooted in the understanding of what Christ is doing, the resurrected Christ is doing in us, through us, and among us, as highlighted in this scripture. So one of the things that happens when I teach the Bible and when we encounter the miraculous works of Jesus in the gospel text is that when Jesus is doing a miracle that's happening physically in somebody's body, he's also displaying what it is that he does for the rest of us all the time. So one of the things, for example, that's happening when Jesus meets someone who cannot see and he heals their physical bodies and allows them to see clearly for the first time ever, Jesus is also making it very clear to us that that's what he does for all people everywhere. When Jesus finds someone who's not able to physically hear and understand what is being said around them with true purpose and truth, and he makes that possible for them physically, he's also making it clear that's what he makes possible for other people everywhere. That's one of the things that's happening in these texts, and it's perfectly described in a powerful and gut-wrenching way in our scripture reading today. A man has been waiting for 38 years by the side of a pool, praying for healing that isn't coming. He's tried this one way over and over and over again for 38 years, and he is stuck. And he has given up hope, and he has given up dreaming, and he has given up truly believing that things could ever get better for him. This man has been trying one way for 38 years, and he is stuck. He feels alone. He feels lost. He has no hope. And Jesus comes up to this man. It's amazing. Jesus comes up to this man and he doesn't say, "Who do you think I am? And if you answer correctly, I'll do something for you." He doesn't come up to this man and say, "How much faith do you have?" He doesn't come up to this man and give him a hypothetical. He doesn't come up to this man and give him a challenge. He comes up to this man who's been stuck in this position, who may have given up hope, who may feel lost, who's been trying one thing in one way over and over and over again, and it still isn't working, and Jesus just asks him a question. Do you want to get well? Do you want to get better? And the man has an explanation. Well, this is what I'm trying, and this is what it's doing. It's not working. Jesus asks the question, do you want to get better? Because that's what I'm offering. I never really thought about it, because I'm not a very deep thinker. That my wife was the loudest one to laugh right there. But if I had to say one of the biggest themes of The Gathering as a worship service, or maybe me as a preacher or community of faith, is the concept of healing. The concept of acknowledging that we actually have real hurts, that we actually have real needs, that we are real people that are really struggling, especially or even when it seems like things are shiny and bright and smooth on the outside. We need real healing. And that's why I'm always talking about, what is it? What's the thing? What's the hurt? What's the struggle today? What's the challenge today? Where are you searching for belonging or security or significance? Because know that the real healing for what's really hurting is found for you in Christ today. So let's find it and let's celebrate it and let's receive what he's doing in us, through us, and for us, because it's too good to wait for just one more day. Do you want to get well in this way? Because it's right here for you. And let's break down every barrier so that you can see it for the first time ever. That's what this service is all about. And we started 6 years ago in a classroom here at the church because it was free. It was available. And we started, we didn't have a band, we didn't have musicians, we didn't have anything else. It was just me, Allie running slides, and a bunch of kolaches. And the service started with this idea of the most important thing that we're doing together as church is not just receiving the sacrament of communion. It's not just reading scripture. It's not just hearing the word proclaimed. It's not just getting a chance to come together with teaching and application and prayer and reflection. But one of the most important things that we can do in life together is do life together and realize that we're not alone. And so from day one, the backbone of the gathering has been a church community that's built around holding a cup of coffee, looking someone in the face and saying hello. How are you doing? Making a friend, making a connection, greeting people that you know elsewhere in the world and coming together and seeing each other face to face. And then we did the number one thing we never should have done. And we outgrew the space. We outgrew the space. And so we went into a season of renovation and making possible a whole new space with larger facilities to increase the capacity of the people who could come and be a part of it. And I love worshiping in the sanctuary so much. The sanctuary is my spiritual home. I love it. It's perfect. I wouldn't change a thing. But one of the powerful things that's possible is when we're in a space that's set up differently, that's built around flat connection and built around looking each other in the eye, and makes possible realizing in a new way that we are not alone. That we're here for healing, and so is everybody else. And that is what Christ is offering us. In just a few minutes, we're going to walk over to our new space. We're going to go out these back doors, and we're going to head over through the garden, and we're going to go into the new renovated Wesley Hall. We have it set up in an atypical way today so that we can accommodate everybody. We don't have the rows set up like you're going to see every Sunday starting next Sunday. Instead, we just have chairs around the edges. I'm going to ask that if you're able to comfortably stand for about 20 minutes, that you find a comfortable place to stand, and you reserve those seats around the edges for people who aren't going to be able to comfortably stand for that length of time. We're going to go over. If you're joining us by live stream, you're coming too. So we're going to go over and move. We're going to have a few minutes when the band plays while we get the technology switched over to live stream from that space. I don't know exactly what that entails. I imagine it's one big switch on the wall, but I don't know. We're going to move over the live stream space as well, and then we're going to consecrate the space together. Consecrating the space means proclaiming what it's here for, praying over it, and uniting our voices to make sure that this facility is used for the healing of souls, the making of disciples, and the praising of God. We're going to do that work together. We're going to receive Holy Communion together. We're going to bless that space, and then we're going to do the most important third thing that we do here at the church, and that is enjoy each other's time together. We're going to hang out. We're going to have kolaches. We're going to drink coffee. We're going to enjoy this beautiful renovated space. And then next Sunday, beginning with next Sunday, the gathering is going to be in that space. So that'll be the facility for the gathering starting next Sunday. And then 11 o'clock traditional service will be here in the sanctuary. One of my favorite things in the history of our church is this history of walking over. For those of you who aren't familiar, this facility was, the ground was broken for it on October 29th, 1929. The day the stock market crashed. And so a church that had saved up its resources to build this facility all of a sudden saw its savings evaporate. But they hung in there. They stayed true to the dream. They stayed true to what it is that God was calling them to do, and they made this church happen. They built this facility that continues to bless us over 90 years later. 2 years later, the construction was finished, and so they did a worship service just like this. They met together in their existing space. They started the worship service, and then they did a walkover to our new facility. They walked from 7th and Taylor over here to 5th and Henderson. And my favorite story is what they did was everyone went outside, and they stood out in the front of the church, and they had the head of the trustees lock the door and turn around and talk about what they were doing and proclaim, "This is what we're doing next." And then he heard a knocking. And looked over his shoulder, and someone from the staff had been locked in. So they went back, and they unlocked it, and they locked it again, and they double-checked, and then they walked over. So friends, let's do one last check. All of you, I think we're here. Walk over to Wesley Hall, get ready, and then we will get started for the next portion of our service in just a few minutes. We'll be right back.
Hello, friends. Y'all, you're being so Methodist, there's not even a front pew and you're not sitting in it. Move forward. Everyone take 3 steps forward. Everyone, welcome to the renovated and expanded Wesley Hall, the home of the gathering and so much more here at our church, a place that's designed to facilitate not only worship and discipleship, community and fellowship, but all for the purposes of changing hearts and lives right here in our city. For those of us who are joining online, welcome. I'm so thankful that you're with us as well. I also want to lift up that this is the conclusion of the next 90 construction and renovation program here at our church. We've expanded the children's facilities at our church. We've upgraded air conditioning and HVAC, all that kind of stuff. We've expanded this space. We've made it all fit for not only the technological needs of now, but a decade into the future. And because of support from the foundation, because of support from individual donors, because of the support of estate gifts, because of the support of your sacrificial living so that you could give generously, we are completing this project and opening it all up with no long-term debt. So all of that allows 100% of our focus to continue to be on ministry going forward. So friends, let's bless and consecrate this space. Brothers and sisters in Christ, this is a day of rejoicing. We have come together to reconsecrate Wesley Hall here at First Church Fort Worth. Let us open our hearts and minds to receive God's word with faith. May our blessed communion, born of one baptism and nurtured at one table of the Lord, become one temple of the Holy Spirit as we gather in love. Dear friends, rejoice that God so moved the hearts of people that this house has been renovated for praise and prayer. Let us now reconsecrate it for service and celebrate its holy use. O eternal God, mighty in power and of incomprehensible majesty, whom the heavens cannot contain, much less the walls of buildings made with hands, we have promised your special presence whenever two or three are assembled in your name to offer praise and prayer. By the power of your Holy Spirit, consecrate this house of your worship. Bless us and sanctify what we do here, that this place may be holy for us and a house of prayer for all people. Guide and empower in this place, by the same Spirit, the proclamation of your word and the celebration of your sacraments, the pouring out of prayer and the singing of your praise, professions of faith and testimonies to your grace, the joining of men and women in marriage, and the celebration of death and resurrection. Save us from that failure of vision, which would confine our worship within these walls. But send us out from here to be your servants in the world, sharing the blessings of Christ with the world he came to redeem. Now, O God, sanctify this place, for everything in heaven and on earth is yours. Yours, Lord, is the dominion, and you are exalted as head above all. Now, as we bless this space, I'm going to lead us, and you're going to join in the response together. We dedicate this space. Let's try that together. We dedicate this space. Excellent. Dear friends, now that we have completed renovating Wesley Hall, let us rededicate this space and rejoice in its holy use. To the glory of God, who has called us by grace to the honor of Jesus Christ, who has loved us and gave himself for us, to the praise of the Holy Spirit who illumines and sanctifies us, we dedicate this space for the worship of God in prayer and praise, for the preaching of the everlasting gospel, for the celebration of the holy sacraments. We dedicate this space for the comfort of all who mourn, for the strength to those who are tempted, for light to those who seek the way. We dedicate this space for the hallowing of family life, for teaching and guiding the young, for the perfecting of the saints. We dedicate this space for the conversion of sinners, for the promotion of righteousness, for the extension of God's reign. We dedicate this space in the unity of faith, in the bond of brotherhood and sisterhood, in love and goodwill to all. We dedicate this space and in gratitude for the labors of all who love and serve this church, in loving remembrance of those who have finished their course, and in the hope of eternal life through Jesus Christ. We dedicate this space. Amen. Brothers and sisters, the first thing, the foundational thing that we have to do in Wesley Hall is celebrate the presence of God through the receiving of communion. Because on the day Christ was to give himself up for us, he had dinner with his followers, the people that had come to know him best, and knowing what they would face, knowing what they would endure, knowing how much change they would see in their lives and in the lives of people to come, he took an ordinary loaf of bread, gave thanks over it, broke it and passed it, and said, "Take all of you and eat. This is my body, which has been broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After the meal was over, He took a cup of ordinary table wine, gave thanks over it, blessed it and passed it, and said, take all of you and drink. This is my blood of the new covenant, the new promise, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And because this is a house of healing, because this is a house of God's grace, because this is a house of the Lord's presence, the first thing that we do together as a community is come to the table. We have six stations set up here at the front. At each one of our stations, we'll have servers who will be holding a basket full of pre-cut bread. As you come forward with your hands held open like this, they'll take a piece of bread, place it in your hand. You're then going to take a cup of pre-filled juice, drink it, and then return backwards in order to make room for other people. We always celebrate communion with non-alcoholic grape juice because we don't want anyone to ever have to choose between sobriety and the sacrament. This is not the gathering's table. This is not the First United Methodist Church's table. This is Christ's table. And like Christ's love, like Christ's grace, like Christ's presence, it's in this space now and always. It is for you today. Every background, every age, every understanding, it is an offer of Christ's love for you. In just a moment, when I release you, I'm going to invite you to come forward naturally to one of these six stations, receive the communion elements, and then return back toward the rear so that someone else can come forward. I'm going to ask that you remain a little bit quiet. We're going to have a space for drinking coffee and eating kolaches and visiting in a minute, but we're going to be first in a moment of worship. So I'm going to invite you, while people are coming forward, while they're receiving communion, while the band is playing, I'm going to invite you to be in prayer, not only for the people here today, but for the people yet to come, because that is why this church has always existed. The table is set. The meal is ready. Come forward and be fed.
I will feast at the table of the Lord. I will feast at the table of the Lord. I won't hunger anymore at his table. I will feast. people of the Lord. He says, come just as you are.
Y'all, we've never served communion to 300 people so quickly. I think chairs are overrated. We should just keep it this way. No, obviously, next week when we gather, next Sunday, back here in the gathering at 9:30, we'll have our chairs set up. I can't wait to return to the form of the gathering that both allows us to have that element of connection and community perfectly built in. I'm so thankful that the space will facilitate it for a much larger crowd. I'm so thankful for all the future things that Christ will continue to do in and through our community. In the back of the room, there is coffee set up and 24 dozen kolaches. There's more coffee in the garden. Children's ministry doesn't let out until 10:45, so we have plenty of time to visit. If you're one of those, please help yourself to a cup of coffee. Hang around and say hello. Before we go, please bow your head and receive this benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May God's face raise to shine upon you. And may the continued presence of Christ in and through this place bless you, your family, and your community now and every day. Amen. Go in peace.